bill that you would and the payment that you will be paying to the TV stations. I hope that you will support my amendment. Dr. Kwakaki. I speak in relation to Head 140 and 144 on the CS4A and CMAB. On number 394 amendment, I asked that we stop paying the annual salary of the CS4A that involves a sum of $3.9 million. Mrs. Carrie Lam, I believe, is one of the most trusted officials in Hong Kong. But seeing her performance starting from October 2013 up to now, I think she is betraying Hong Kong. She's been serving as a government official for Hong Kong for so many years. There is no reason that she doesn't understand that we are in a critical juncture in Hong Kong. She's served the colonial government and also the SARG government. She knows exactly what Hong Kong people need, what is fake and what is genuine. With her competence, she should know all these things well. But surprisingly, she wrote all these materials in this consultation paper. She insulting Hong Kong people by doing that. In the last round, she said that let's talk, and then not sooner than we have this pocketed first slogan. I think this is a scam here. Well, you would only ask people to pocket it first in a scam. Well, just like people selling fake drugs. Well, take it first, pocket it first. Say if a person is ill, and you know that there is real medication, genuine medication, and there are fake drugs, and if you give prescribe the genuine drugs, then that person can be saved. But then you are prescribing the fake drugs to him and ask them to take it first. And if this person is ill, is facing death, then if you prescribe the fake drugs to him, then he will die. So this is what we are seeing today. What the government is doing by presenting this fake universal suffrage proposal, making it happen. Mrs. Carrie Lam has served for many years in the government. And she's called the nanny of the senior government officials. That's a befitting name for her, because whatever mistakes we face, and she will come out and try to remedy it first. For example, there's a problem with the landfills. She helped with Wong Kam Sing. Poverty alleviation, that falls on her shoulders as well. And political reform, the same applies. Well, of course, constitutional reform falls under the portfolio of the CS4A. Among the government officials, there are only few who have good popularity rating. We don't have any aspiration at all on CY Leung and Carrie Lam. Well, we hold this illusion that well, she seems to be a tough lady, and she seems very smart, and she knows what kind of person CY Leung is, and she should be able to help to speak the truth for Hong Kong people and to resist some evil tactics of CY Leung. She would be able to speak the truth, to tell right from wrong. But her performance in the past few years has been most disappointing. She tells lies all the time. We may remember in January, we had this public sentiment report. She presented it. After we heard about the August 31st MPCSE decision, which was very restrictive, all strata of the society and not just the academia. The average man on the street, someone from Outer Kok and Yao Ma Te, well, all of them asked us, what is this? Is this called universal suffrage? But then she, Carrie Lam, repeated her lies all the time. And she gets sympathy from people because she is a female official. She said that she had done her utmost and either take it or leave it. Well, we may believe her if she said it for one time, twice or even twice, but then she said the same thing all over again. She tried to beautify the lies. She refused to tell the truth. If she can bow to prejudice just for the sake of several million dollars of salary, then we have mistrusted her. She didn't even have the courage to speak the truth and to tell right from wrong. Well, if she said that this 2017 proposal is not a perfect proposal, but we've done our best, and that is the best proposal we can get from the CPG, this is a rotten proposal. As a government official, I've already done my best. Well, if she had said something like that, then, well, we knew that she still got a little conscience and she knows what is right and what is wrong. But no, she's not doing that. She is reversing the truth in her remarks. She said that this is genuine universal suffrage. What kind of universal suffrage is that? A small circle election by 1,200 people, and the central authorities can control the election, and then the people should get half of the support from half of the NC members before they can stand for election. Well, we don't have any genuine choices. We are just substituting the election committee with the nominating committee this time. We will end up with just someone appointed or anointed by the CPG. And they said, and they told you that this is genuine universal suffrage. Well, there's one point she is a little bit more honest. And we asked her whether this is a proposal which is the ultimate scheme or the end game. But no, this paper is very clear about that. If the electoral endorses it, then we have already achieved the requirements of Article 45 on the universal suffrage for returning the CE. So we will pocket it forever. Now, some people asked whether there will be a change after 2020. Then she said that will depend on the situation and how the CE then will view it. Well, whatever happens at time has nothing to do with her, because she will not no longer very likely to be in the position. This proposal will stay forever. While she may not get elected if she stands for election, that's what happened to Henry Tang. Well, the CPG can support you, but later they can withdraw their support for you. Well, China is very powerful. Pakistan, the whole of Asia, the whole of Europe get scared about China, and the Taiwan political parties, of various political parties, would like to meet with Xi Jinping. And say the army from Shenzhen can be mobilized to come to Hong Kong at any time. So what are there any there are no security threats in Hong Kong. There are so many spies around on the mainland.
In fact, in Hong Kong, we don't have state secrets. We can only read the newspaper. Now, concerning Bo Xilai, what happened to him is state secret. In Hong Kong, there aren't any state secrets. Mrs. Carrie Lam has been a high-ranking official in Hong Kong for a long time. Some say that this present task is going to be her last important task in this SAR. Some say that it's of course difficult to make a good start, but it's even more important that you end your career well. But now people just think that you're associated with someone like C.Y. Leung. You keep telling lies like many others. And so what started off well ended in a disaster. We don't want to see that happen. As a conscientious official, Mrs. Carrie Lam shouldn't have stayed in this mess. She shouldn't have allowed herself to be associated with C.Y. Leung. She shouldn't have put forward such a bad package of proposals. This is a very bad ending, or this is going to be a very bad ending for her. So I think there are definitely much better ways to end a career. Yes, at this juncture, we are quite near to genuine universal suffrage. And I think we should be trying to get as much as possible from the central authorities. Our country ranks second in terms of GDP. Different countries in the world are trying very hard to befriend our country. You see agreements signed between our country and many other countries in the world, including the UK. And I think our country should be magnanimous enough to allow universal suffrage in Hong Kong. And what's going to happen in Hong Kong will affect what's going to happen in our country. What is the way forward for our country? Is it that our country will keep on arresting dissidents on Women's Day, International Women's Day? There were a few activists who demanded that women must not be sexually abused. And what happened to them? Carrie Lam has not lived up to the expectations of Hong Kong people. Hong Kong people do have a lot of expectations about her. And I think she has not really done what she should do for our country. Hong Kong may not have universal suffrage, and our country may not be able to know from the experiment in this small SAR that democracy will only benefit the country and people are rational and peaceful, and national security will not be threatened. And if our country can develop in this way, then it will have a future. Otherwise, it will remain a closed country. Does any member wish to speak? Mr. Albert Chen. Mr. Chairman, when I spoke, I said that our police officers had become city management. And I said that police officers who abused their authority might have committed crime. And might get convicted elsewhere. And Mr. Lam Kwok-hung talked about unlawful arrests by police officers. He gave an account of his personal experience. I think when we talk about the number of people that are harmed by police officers, the extent of the harm, yes, you may say that the situation is not as bad as in Eastern Europe some decades ago, but I think the essence or the nature is the same, and that is the government, the rulers abusing their powers to inflict harm on the people. Those concerned were tried and punished under international law. In fact, you can read about these stories in history books. Goring in Nazi Germany, the successor to Hitler, was sentenced to death, but then he committed suicide before the punishment. And then we have Joachim von Ribbentrop. He was the foreign minister, and he was also sentenced to death. And then there was another one, sentenced to death, and he was Wilhelm Keitel. And now I will not read out the names, I will only read out their posts. I want to know why you've mentioned these names and these people. How are they relevant to the matter being debated on? There are over 70 amendments that I have proposed, and they relate to cutting the expenditure for the CS office, the CE's office, the salary of the CE, the salary of the CS, the salary of the S4S, the salary of the commissioner, and so on and so forth. And I want to point out that I have moved these amendments because these officers, these officials, have abused their powers. And I, in fact, in an earlier speech, pointed out that because they abuse their powers, they might be tried and they might be convicted. And I want to put forward further evidence to show that even if you hold public office and you can exercise public powers, you will be tried by history, by your conscience, by the people, and under the law. And I'm now trying to provide further information and evidence concerning this. And maybe members will also be tried. and foreign minister, the criminal prosecution minister, and then the governor of the Poland occupation area, the minister of internal affairs, and then the representative for labor affairs. Now, Mr. Albert Chan, I think the evidence you've provided doesn't really help you further your argument. But Chairman, in the last session, I said that the officials concerned should resign if they still had a conscience. And I am trying to give some evidence to show them that they should not think that they can do whatever they like because they have their powers. Sorry, Chairman, I think I want a quorum count. 17-3. Okay.
Can I read it?
Mr. Albert Chan. Chairman, when I asked for a quorum count, the pro-establishment members said that I was below standard. I had nothing to say. That is why I wanted a quorum count. In fact, I was protesting against the unreasonable ruling of the deputy or to the president. Thank you for coming back, President. I have 60 pages for speaking on because I like to talk about different bureaus and departments, and I will have something to say even until next week. Talking about the departments, of course, is important, but also the political theories should also be given. I was talking about history just now. I was talking about the Nazi officials who were sent to death or life imprisonment or 10 to 20 years in prison. I would not go into the details. I just like to put on record that when you have the power, when you have the positions in government, now even those who did not take part in the massacre, some people were responsible for the manufacture of military equipment. Those were given over 20 years of imprisonment as well. So the entire ruling party could be imprisoned. Coming back to the theories, in my amendments, many are about cutting the salaries of bureau directors and secretaries of departments. Those who still have a conscience should not be part of the ruling group, which does not have any credibility. They should resign because they don't tell the truth. Why is it important to tell the truth? Those who are in the resistance movement should know Havel very well. He is a political theorist of Czechoslovakia. He was also the then president. He is, of course, a very famous person detailing political theories. Under the communist rule, nobody spoke the truth. The Communist Party was able to govern with lies, and I think Havel just knew this too well. That is why in his works, especially in The Power of the Powerless, he said many times that lies are evil and lies can distort humanity. Which head are you talking about? I am talking about cutting the salaries of directors of bureaus and secretaries of departments, including the CE's office. I am referring to Amendment 1, 5, 8, and you can go on. Many of these amendments have to do with reducing the salaries of the bureaus and departments, especially the CE's office. Since you are speaking a number of times already, please do not say anything that has nothing to do with the heads of expenditure. Chairman, Mr. Siwa Leung is famous for telling lies. He used lies to secure his position of CE. The entire accountability team, all the bureau directors and secretaries of departments, they support this lying administration. I was asking for cutting their salaries and appealing them to resign, and all this has to do with lying. And I'm talking about the harm that lies can do to society and also the importance of telling the truth. I have proposed 72 amendments to cut those salaries, and that is why I'm trying to explain why I want to do that. Please give me just a little more time, Chairman, to quote from Havel and how he talked about lying and telling the truth, and then I would be able to complete my explanation to this part. Havel said, if pillars of society live among lies, then those people who live amongst truth will be its biggest and fundamental threat. That is why this crime should be subject to more severe penalty than other crimes. And people would speak from humanity and their conscience when they speak the truth, and this is very terrible for an authoritarian ruler. the cells of truth will infiltrate a body of lies, and in the end, it will dismember the entire body of lies.
So if we continue telling the lies, well, then this dictatorial government will be continue to be there. Well, once the time is ripe, and an armed ordinary member of the public can dissipate the military force, and this doesn't participate directly in the political struggle, but will have an impact on this unpredictable situation. And uprising, which came up suddenly, will introduce change to a society which doesn't seem to be able to be changed. We can't tell when this last moment will come, this last blow will come. So to go against this lying government, the most important tool is to tell the truth, especially our Secretary for Justice, our police, our security bureau continue to tell lies, even though the court has pointed out clearly that these people have provided false evidence in the court. The bureau directors are still encouraging and condoning people to tell the lie at the court. If we tolerate such lies, this society will be going down the road of destruction. If we can't tell the truth, and if we don't point out the damage of such lies, then you should step down from your position, because you are colluding with the evil forces in the society, and the society will go down the route of destruction. Under the communist rule, 26 years ago, after the fall of the Berlin Wall, Czechoslovakia was embarking on the road of democracy. And Havel, with his leadership, was taking Czechoslovakia on the route of democracy, and he succeeded in continuing his position as the president of that nation. So by telling the truth, he got the support from the public and his people. Mr. Chen, I don't think that you are speaking in relation to the hits of the appropriation bill. I think it's all related. You are entitled to your opinion, of course, Chairman. Why do I want to cut the salaries of these bureau directors? Because they are telling lies. And why I propose to cut the salary of C.Y. Lam? Because he is the king of lies. So this example of Czechoslovakia can be applicable to Hong Kong. President, you study politics. And the Czechoslovakia in the 60s is very much like the society we are having in Hong Kong today. And the ruling approach at that time in Czechoslovakia is very similar to what we've seen at the umbrella movement in Hong Kong. Dr. Kwok-hung, I continue to speak in relation to Head 144 on CMAB. And before that, I would like to talk about Head 23 in relation to the auxiliary medical service. In the last debate, when we talked about DH, the secretary was not here, but then he is here today. So AMS, this is the subject that I want to talk about. AMS, helps the government in providing healthcare services, including emergency services and rescue services. Recently, after 2003, AMS has been helping more with epidemic diseases, including stationing at BCPs and customs points to help with health checks of people. With regard to infectious disease control, I would like to say something. A couple of days ago, the government announced ending this period of seasonal flu. The number of deaths in relation to flu has reached a record high in the past several years. With regard to our preparedness for flu, seasonal flu, the number of vaccinations for young people and the elderly, the ratio was very low compared to Taiwan, Japan. Well, we should feel ashamed of ourselves. So that's why the AMS is seeing increasing workload in recent years, and that has to do with our healthcare policies and our lack of preparedness to deal with seasonal flu. The government doesn't have long-term plans and doesn't have the capacity and the determination to do something to cope with the situation. Where does the problem lie? Is it the case that we don't have enough money? No, we are an affluent society. Well, it's inconceivable to say that we don't have the means. I think we don't have the determination, rather. If we ask people of various ages whether they have got vaccination against seasonal flu, very often we got a negative answer. This is an important public health care policy, and the government is not determined to do it. So this is very disappointing to the public. I don't want to spend too much time on this, although the secretary is here. I don't think he's going to respond. Anyway, I want to go back to 144 CMAB. Yesterday, Mr. Raymond Tam went to a busy area on the Hong Kong island, and he was interviewed by a mobile radio station, and he was quite embarrassed. Some members of the public in relation to his role as the secretary of CMA, and at this critical juncture, he didn't do a proper job to meet with public aspirations. And this member of the public said that he was a lying secretary and he has not lived up to the reputation of his alma mater and so on. And he was very embarrassed. On the question of constitutional reform, this is an issue close to the heart of Hong Kong people in the past couple of years. The basic law sets out clearly the provision in relation to the universal suffrage for returning the CE. And Article 45 states that clearly, and this is one of the missions of the three-man task force, and it is an important responsibility of the CMAB. But then the CMAB has not been discharging its duties properly. Let's discuss, that's the slogan. But what we are seeing is that the deputations, the groups met with by the task force, they are just the friends, the insiders. Most of them are the pro-establishment groups. So these are the groups which were willing to accept these proposals we found unacceptable. So one member of the public called up the station and said, Mrs. Carrie Lam, you got it all wrong. And she said that she felt that most of the people support the 831 decision. Well, the member of the public said, well, you should say all groups that you met support this proposal because you are just seeing the pro-establishment groups. So you are just listening to what you like to hear. Have you gone to the occupied areas? Some 1 million people participated in the Occupy movement. Have you had a real dialogue with the ordinary members of the public? And those you met are your friends. And you got all the tickets distributed to your friends, and you are surrounded by a big group of security personnel. Well, Meifu is a very good example. According to some reports, what happened in Meifu is that there were groups of people taken by coaches to the area. They are not the residents of Meifu. And these groups were staging dances, and they seemed to be painting a picture, a very rosy picture. And they asked him whether you would like to accept this proposal. Of course, they said that they will accept the proposal because they are the supporters and your friends. And perhaps they will be treated to a meal afterwards even. So this is the level of governance that we are seeing in Hong Kong. It's like the story from the king's new outfit. You are telling lies. You ask people to support you in your remarks, saying that this is genuine universal suffrage. How can you be accountable to Hong Kong people, the young generation in particular? What is this bureau doing? Is this bureau deteriorating into a lying bureau? Mainland affairs also falls under its portfolio. As a Chinese person, of course, I hope that there will not be any corruption in our nation. I hope that our country will also govern in accordance with the law. There will be fairness in the state. I dare not say democracy, but there is a fair approach, and the people of the state can have a real, a good channel to seek grievance or to seek a redress for unfair dealings. Now, for CMAB, they haven't learned anything good from this day, but rather they have learned to lie. They would rather lie than tell the truth. So they would be catching up with the mainland in that regard. So that's why they call themselves mainland affairs, because they are following the practices of the mainland. We Hong Kong people used to have certain aspirations on Raymond Tam and Carrie Lam. We did have expectations on them. We hope that they can speak the truth. For mainland officials, Wang Guangya, Li Fei, well, they might have to tell some lies to them. It's essential if you want to deal with mainland officials. But at least they should tell some truth and not all lies. Now, there are lies after lies in this consultation paper. In the public sentiment report released earlier this year, it's a 1,000-page document. It's most staggering. While most of the reports comprise newspaper cuttings only, while they are doing the job even worse than Wise News. The Wise News will get the clips, all the clips. They will be sharing part of the truth. But then they are screening out some parts of the truth. And the conclusion they have is that the comments are very staggering, the comments they present.
They said most people supported the decision made by the MPCSC in August. There was no strong objection. And as a result, the Bureau thinks that Hong Kong supports the MPCSC's decision. In fact, we all have Wise News. Why do we need this Bureau to tell us things that do not represent the truth? Why do we want this Bureau to reflect to us so-called public opinion when they are not, or when it is not public opinion? We have the CPU, we have other similar bodies. So why do we need the CMAB? So please don't waste taxpayers' money when you're going to say things that you want to say anyway. The Bureau needs to spend over $20 million a year. Of course, the government may say this is really a very small amount of money, but the public are disappointed. They can't help asking what the secretary and what the undersecretary and the others in the Bureau are doing. Are they really trying to promote constitutional and political development in Hong Kong? Are they acting in accordance with the spirit contained in Article 45 of the Basic Law? Raymond Tam may get further promotion, or he may retire in a few years' time, and I don't know how his former classmates and his schoolmates will treat him. You know, former students of the school put up an announcement urging people like Raymond Tam to tell the truth and refrain from telling lies. But we all know what sort of person he is in the eyes of the public. Things have come to such a pass. Can Raymond Tam and Carrie Lam wash their hands of the matter? The answer is, of course, no. Of course, the central authorities and their faithful follower in Hong Kong, CY Leung, are the culprits. But we really can't communicate with CY Leung. So we can only place our confidence in high-ranking officials that we knew so well. But now we know that there can be no illusions. Once they are in those polls, they will not speak the truth. Carrie Lam, Raymond Tam, they will only say things that are pleasing to the ears of Beijing. They will not tell us the truth. Mr. Kwok-hung, Mr. Albert Chen talked about Czechoslovakia. I believe many of you have been there, and in the public square there are many statues, and Then you can also see the graves of two young persons. They're very small. They committed suicide when the USSR troops marched into the country. I have moved one amendment on slashing the salaries of EXCO members and all secretaries of department and directors of bureau. This is collective crime. In 1968, Havel was just a writer, a junior staff member in a government department, and he became the president. And do you know his deputy president? In fact, he was a very respectable person. Whether you elected by the people, you have to work for the people. If you are in that post, you have to do your work. You have to work for the benefit of the people. You are accountable to yourself, not just to the voters, to others. Chairman, you may think that I'm digressing. No, I'm not. I want to say that under the basic law, we can only impeach the CE, but not the secretaries of department and directors of bureaus. So in overseas countries, if something scandalous occurs to a minister, then there is a mechanism to remove him. But in Hong Kong, we can't do that because we don't have genuine universal suffrage. So I go back to the two graves, the two small graves. Keep reminding people that they need to tell the truth. The deputy president was anointed and appointed by the USSR at the time. At that time, the USSR said that sovereignty was limited and not without bounds. That was the socialist belief of the USSR. The deputy president at the time was similar to our CE. He was a member of the Communist Party, and he was one of the heads of the state. But then he said that people should not be arrested arbitrarily. He didn't ask for ask for universal suffrage in Czechoslovakia. He just thought that for some public bodies there could be elections. He was for humanitarian socialism. On the 21st of August 1968, people were sad when they heard that Czechoslovakia had fallen into the hands of the Communist Party. I was 12 years old at that time, and I thought, how come this country had such a long name, Czechoslovakia? Six characters in Chinese. Now, what I want to say is that in the government, the CE gets his power. He, of course, was elected by a small circle of people. And then EXCO members, high-ranking officials, they are in a position of trust. They have to serve the people of Hong Kong. Now, Secretary, you know that civil servants are not politically accountable. They just follow the rules. They just follow the civil service regulations. Well, Carrie Lam is an official. Why is it that she thinks she has a political mission to lead Hong Kong people down a certain road? This deputy president was responsible to himself. He was kidnapped to USSR, and he was sent to a foreign consular post, and then he was demoted to the post of a gardener. That was because he liked gardening. Today, the CE claims that he wants to lead Hong Kong people to solve deep-rooted problems. He claims that he is leading Hong Kong people towards universal suffrage. He claims that he is trying to remove the or to get rid of the small circle elections, which have given rise to deep-rooted problems. And now we see what proposals he has for us. And he is saying that we must make it happen. And he accuses others of collaborating with external forces. Should he still be regarded as a human being? The deputy minister of the deputy president of Czechoslovakia didn't yield under pressure. He was a great man. Donald Zhang once said that he was a Hong Konger and he drank Hong Kong water, so he was deeply attached to Hong Kong. I think our officials are expected to really work for the well-being of Hong Kong. Let me say this. Article 49 to Article 52 of the Basic Law. We have these arrangements which can help the central authorities and Hong Kong people get out of this impasse. Article 49. If the CE of the Hong Kong SAR considers that a bill passed by LegCo is not compatible with the overall interests of the region, he or she may return it to the LegCo within 3 months for reconsideration. If the LegCo passes the original bill again by not less than a two-thirds majority of all the members, the CE must sign and promulgate it within 1 month or act in accordance with the provisions of Article 50 of this law. In fact, I have read Article 50 before. The CE says that we should be voted out of office because we only represent the minority. There isn't another piece of legislation which is provided for in Annex 1, which has to obtain two-thirds majority of all members. If you say this is not an important bill, then what is it? So invoke upon Article 50. Let's just ask the people whom they support. The people can tell us whether this composition of this LegCo can represent them. The public can tell you whether the voting inclinations of members in this council represent their voting inclinations. So I want to say that the arrangements outlined in Article 49 and 50 represent the arrangements for a de facto referendum. This is a mechanism designed by the Communist Party to check and balance or to check the powers of the CE, if he is not obedient. On the other day, I asked Carrie Lam, yes or no, and she said, Mr. Lam Kwok-hung, you should adopt a more pragmatic approach. In fact, I am extremely pragmatic. I am saying that we should deal with the matter in a fair and just manner and rational manner. People say I always talk nonsense. Can I ask the pro-establishment members whether they've really read the basic law carefully?
It is negligent on the part of the CE not to mention this. And Carrie Lam thought that she needed not remind the CE. So she did nothing. Rimsky-Yun, he should be responsible for researching into the law, but he did not do anything. And he only referred to 158 bracket 3 of the basic law, that the interpretation power remains with the NPC. So all the way to Raymond Tam, and he teases us. He says public opinion has changed, and Democrats should not just gesticulate. Is he quite sick? Why is he saying that we are gesticulating? What officials are you? You say make it happen. Let me tell you this. Mao Zedong also thought that Hua Guofeng would make it happen, because he said to him that when you do things, I have no worries. And Mao Zedong told Jiang Qing that things would remain unchanged after he died, but it did not happen that way. Only God, only an authoritarian government would say there is certainty that Moses will not be able to go to Cana. Now, how can you make something to happen for certain? Only Stalin, Mao Zedong, and other powers like that can say those things. Mr. Chairman, we use the example of Czechoslovakia to prove that the entire government is negligent of duty. The entire government was pointed at by a gun. It was a machine gun that was pointing at the entire Czechoslovakia government. Dare you? Actually, at that time, the Czechoslovakia government could have just said, we welcome the Russian army, and then they could remain in power. Aren't we quite similar in our situation? Wang Jingwei said more or less the same thing. If you can't fight your enemy, and also to avoid more pain caused to the Chinese people, Jiang Jieshi could not do anything, and why don't you pocket it first? It could have happened that way. They were quite courageous at that time, and the country covered a big area then. Chairman, I in fact don't want to teach people how to conduct themselves, but I'm saying here in the council that somebody told me, oh come on, long hair, you have been fighting for this for many years and still you have failed. What else can you give Hong Kong people? Chairman, I just want to say one thing. I want to be the one pointing out that the emperor has no clothes on him, that he is naked. Because if I point it out, then there is a chance for the emperor to put on some clothes. I want to point out to the CCP that what it does in Hong Kong now is wrong, so it has a chance to do the right thing on the mainland. This is what I want to say. Chairman, somebody said, if you don't pocket it now, you will never have it. My response is simple. If you sell off your right to be the first heir, you will never get it back. This is what the Bible tells us. It will only cause a family tragedy. Plus, the CCP is asking us to be Abraham, to kill his own son, to prove that we trust him. Oh, come on. Get it out. Does any other member wish to speak? Mr. Raymond Chan? Thank you, Chairman. In this part, I would like to talk about Amendment number 31, Head 21, Chief Executive's Office, subhead 000, in order to reduce the expenditure 000, so that $2.76 million would be taken away from Head 21, which is equal to the annual estimate of salary for the information coordinator. We all know that this IO is Andrew Fung. In our amendment, apart from myself, Mr. Raymond Wong, Mr. Albert Chen, Mr. Kenneth Chen, we are all moving similar amendments, and that is Andrew Fung's annual salaries would totally be cut. If we need a referendum to kick out officials, apart from the directors of bureaus and secretaries of departments, I think this IO Andrew Fung would certainly be one selected. This will be the wish of the people, and he cannot remain. Now, what is the truth? He is the target of the people, yet he remains firmly in post. This is the irony of the government we have. It was rumored that CY Leung would appoint Andrew Fung to be the IO of the CE's office. The community and the political circle already made a lot of comments. Would this person be worth an annual salary of $2.76 million? But unfortunately, public opinion could not change the decision of the CE. On the contrary, Andrew Fung could be said to be mirroring CY Leung. The more people that object to him, the more firmly he is rooted in his post. Why would CY Leung want Andrew Fung to be the IO? At the start, we were scratching our heads. We could not understand. I analyzed the situation, and I would like to make 2 points. Number one, that Andrew Fung is an eyesore. He is so hated. I mean, it is difficult to find another one who is as hated as CY Leung. If I were to ask you to find another one to fit in that position using this condition, I challenge you to make a better nomination. Secondly, that he is totally incompetent. He repeatedly make mistakes. He deliberately make mistakes. He does not shy away from making mistakes. The more mistakes he makes, the more firmly he is rooted in his post. Again, this is like the destiny of CY Leung. This is why CY Leung wants him. Have you seen that CY Leung has always had very low ratings? He is also the most hated. He is also the target of criticism at this council. But in the days past, when a bureau director or an executive councillor was plagued by a scandal, then they would be sharing out the political pressure on CY Leung. CY Leung's ratings would stop to drop, and public opinion and headlines of newspapers would turn the criticism to directors of bureaus and councillors, executive councillors who were plagued by scandals, so the CE could have some reprieve. If someone would make a mistake every day, if the papers would report him every day, if he is the IO, then CY Leung would love it because he would be his cover. He would be the sandbag protecting him. So someone would be fronting him to be criticized by newspapers. And in fact, we could trace this back to CY Leung, because CY Leung recruited him, and CY Leung would have to give his nod before Andrew Fung would have engaged in such deeds. There is this editorial today saying that CY Leung went to the districts to promote the constitutional development package, but that was not his objective. He did not go there to secure public opinion. He was there to divert people's attention, because in fact he did not say anything about the proposals. He were only refuting people who were scolding him. He said that people used invectives against him, that people put up unfriendly gestures. And in fact, a stage was built in Meifu, and older women were dancing on stage. Oh, we were laughing at him, but he in fact was happy because he could think of this trick to anger Hong Kong people. So the objective of Si Wai Leong and Andrew Fung was to anger people, to irritate people in Hong Kong or the pan-democrats and all who want to fight for real universal suffrage. He was in the districts on different occasions last year. He brought his fans along. Triads were protecting him. And in the end, he would only comment on the chaos caused, and he would be silent on the issues of his original concern. Coming back to Andrew Fung, I'd like to talk about his crimes and record of bad deeds. I can't give you an inexhaustive list, but on the top of that list, let me give you 2-3 examples because I won't have enough time to go into all of them. He is the official IO of the government, but then during the umbrella movement, on Lung Wah Road, when the police and protesters entered into a violent confrontation, a media organization filmed police officers take a protester to beat him up in a dark corner. And then there was this photo on the internet that someone who looked like to be in police uniform had his back of his hand bleeding, and it was supposed that he was hurt by protesters, and many blue ribbons and other people were saying that according to this photo, protesters were the one causing injury and the policemen were the victims. But then if you had common sense, you would see that it was a counterfeit photo, and as the IO, Andrew Fung did not verify the truth of the picture. He wrote on his Facebook saying that nobody is right if he resorted to violence, and if police are hurt on duty, they warrant our sympathy, and the spirit of democracy includes compassion. And netizens, of course, are discerning, and they actually dug up the photo, which was put together by this stunt makeup artist, and he was actually using that picture in an episode filmed for TVB. And of course, there was so much irony caused. But this one, Andrew Fung, is an IO, a public official, receiving an annual salary of $2.76 million. And last month, Si Wai Leong, before attending an exco meeting, was receiving petition letters at the petition area. In the presence of the ISD, Andrew Fung filmed the situation. And a few hours later, the filmlet or the footage appeared in the Speak Out for Hong Kong Facebook page. And it was said that it was filmed by a reader using a mobile phone, but it was from the angle where Andrew Fung was standing. It showed that actually Si Wai Leong did not leave in a rush, but he stood there for a while to listen. And then reporters asked Andrew Fung afterwards whether he supplied the footage to a website outside the government. He did not respond directly. He only said that it is his habit to film some footage for the sake of record. Netizens again laughed at him. He is taking a salary of $2.76 million for a year. He is a high-ranking official in the government. But he acts like any other netizen. I think it's a waste of public money. From this episode, if the IO is the aide of Mr. Si Wai Leong, saying that you would like to keep evidence to show that your boss listens to public opinion instead of leaving the petitioners in a rush, then why don't you do it just like that? Put it on the official website or the CEO's Facebook page or the ISD Facebook page instead of using your private mobile phone during official hours. Well, that is what he claimed. And puts it on the internet in the capacity as a netizen or an average member of the public. He actually supplied it to an unofficial website. And, well, he was caught red-handed, but before that, he was releasing information in an undercover way, and it was all done by him. He also wrote articles in other people's names. And quite recently, he had this war of words with Choi Chi-kang, a lecturer of CU Hong Kong, because Choi Chi-kang wrote an article saying that CY Leung was happy to engage in struggles, that Mr. CY Leung was trying to consolidate his position by staging struggles. But then Andrew Fung wrote in the newspaper to refute the argument, saying that some academics were actually the mouthpiece of the opposition party, that they were spreading their wrong political convictions on the campus, and he satirizes Mr. Choi for not concentrating on academic matters. He did not deny that he wrote in the name of Kam Chung-yen. We all know that actually that is the alter ego of Andrew Fung. He did not act like previous IOs who adopted a low profile. He actually interfered into academic freedom.
Professor Choi Chi-kang, as an academic, is obliged to point out mistakes in the society, and he would not consider the ruler's viewpoint in writing his articles. Now, if Andrew Fung is getting a fee for writing the articles, and that would go against the civil servants' code, and that is if civil servants publish articles in newspapers, and if he receive a fee, then he should get the approval from the department head or his superior before doing that. But then the C's office has handled the matter in a low-profile manner and didn't comment on whether Andrew Fung has breached the relevant code. There is another incident earlier, and Andrew Fung wrote on the Facebook around 5 p.m. in his own capacity, and he was criticized as using his office hours to do private matters. But actually, he said that he's already off, but then official records show that he should have his official office hours should last till 6 p.m. CY Leung's appointment of Andrew Fung has all along been criticized by the Hong Kong public. And our greatest recollection of him before he assumed office was that Andrew Fung's PR company, while he was the person in charge of the PR company, was appointed by the HAB to deal with elections of the Hong Kong Arts Development Council. And there were duplicated counting. And originally, each elector should get 10 ballot papers to vote for 10 candidates. But then when the votes were counted, it was found that there were 11 papers instead of 10. So the organizer discussed how to deal with the situation, and the voting results were only announced at around 5 a.m. the next day. And Andrew Fung made an apology of that. Well, this was a stupid mistake, and he said that it has to do with the publishing company's mistake, and that the number of the public papers has been taken out just to protect or safeguard the candidate's privacy. Well, anyway, he took responsibility and he apologized, and he said that the printing of the ballot papers should be done by the government printer for the electoral and district council election so that mistakes could be minimized. We didn't quite get it. Why CY Leung has decided to appoint Andrew Fung Well, perhaps for the reasons that I set out earlier, because he's incompetent, he's shameless, and he will be sharing up the negative news report. So, but that would not be the reason for us to support the funding for his salary. So I urge that we cut the salary of Andrew Fung, $2.7 million. Mr. Leung Kwok-hung, Mr. Raymond Chan asked a wrong question. And this government official was Gorin was trying to burn out all the books. I would like to talk about Andrew Fung and all those government officials who try to whitewash the government policies for CY Leung. If you remember clearly, then we have talked about Tang Wai-kwan, Ms. Tang Kwai-wan, and we wonder why Ms. Tang was appointed, because she wasn't considered very competent. But she resigned later on, and it was smart of her to do so. She said that she didn't have enough competence to go on overseas visit with CY Leung. But Andrew Fung, he was so shameless. When Carrie Lam made her statement, I was interviewed by BC, and they asked me, what's your attitude? How do you assess the situation? I said, yes. It was like going back to the novel of 1984, written by George Orwell. And there was this truth department and also the war department within this novel. War is peace. And I remember correctly, and I said, lies are the truth. Well, I was embarrassed. I couldn't remember the exact remarks or the story. Anyway, if we use that remark to assess Mr. Andrew Fung's performance and also the CPU's performance, Mr. Xu Xinpo of the CPU, Mr. Xu Xinpo said that they are going to fight a war based on public opinion. They are going to conduct opinion polls. Public opinion is supposed to improve your governance, but now they are using public opinion they are conducting public opinion polls to create public opinion. Mr. Wong quoted from Chairman Mao, he started the Cultural Revolution. Whenever a class of society wished to overturn another class, they had to create certain public opinion. So that's why we saw what happened at the Cultural Revolution. Three intellectuals suffered as a result. That was a very wicked situation back then. The CY Leung, CE, spent a lot of money on CPU, and the team led by Andrew Fung, what have they done? All they did is to tell lies. That's like the situation in 1984. It's truth department. Innocence is power. That's what is said. Hong Kong people should be innocent. Or naive, rather. We are not asking the government to publicize on our behalf. We expect the government to remain neutral. That is to say, if you do consultation, then you'll be frank about it, and there are two different sides of views, and it shouldn't be the case that there is this train of thought which should work, and anyone who opposes it should be in the wrong. It's like the Jesus being treated and Jesus was full of wisdom. Whatever belongs to Caesar should go back to Caesar. Whatever belongs to God should be returned to God. He is a man of wisdom. How can you do things like the way you're doing? This is the way you do it is most surprising. It's like the government has gone mad, has gone crazy. It's like a self-fulfilling prophecy. You said that 2 months later, you would make it happen. So what will you do? This is the crux of the problem. So that's why today, we see that people are not behaving in their normal way. Who used to be the ladies and gentlemen now have become the rascals because you've got a deadline. Well, who told Moses in Mount Sinai when he should go into Canaan? Well, it's you yourself who decided on the deadline, and then you are trying to stop the filibustering here to pave the way for them. I'm talking about Andrew Fong and his team. I think this whole strategy is wrong because he said, make it happen. If you think truth is on your side, then I would defend to the end your right to oppose me. And that is to say, I am the Buddha, and you will be within my control. You cannot get out of my control. Then I would letting you have come up with all the arguments, and then I will refute you one by one. But it's not like the situation we are having today. They told us if we are just provided with the choice, take it or leave it. It's like what Goren is proposing. The way you are doing it is like the Gang of Four approach, Yao Wen Yuan's approach. Chairman, people opposed you, and then they were given a death sentence. So what truth can we talk about? Well, it's not that they are or shooting me dead. Well, they are rather insulting my character and integrity. Well, how is it going to do with the information coordinator? Well, it's in every related because CY Leung was accusing us of all kinds of things like trying to see independence, like what Tibet is doing. We're having a colored revolution and so on. And in the discussion between Xi Jinping and Obama, Xi Jinping denied it having any evidence. And Xi Jinping denied it. And Andrew Fung said that if you said that you are guilty, well, show me the evidence that you are not guilty. Well, it's like the Byzantine's ruling and judgment. Well, Mr. Leung, I think what you said is not related to the subject of information coordinating. Yes, that's the way he's approaching things. And actually, a tutor was saying that I made brilliant remarks because you are making good use of historic examples to show your points. Well, do continue with the way you speak. Just don't act like them. Well, saying make it happen all the time. Well, why should I be accused of citing examples from all over the world? Well, I think it's exactly why people are losing out in Hong Kong, because we are not having a wide enough horizon. Well, you are digressing, Mr. Leung. Okay, let me go back to the subject. Why do I criticize these SOJ, the SB, and the police? A lot of people can't tell the difference between the state and the state machinery. Have you switched your focus? Well, Mr. Lang, well, to estate, Mr. Lang, are you talking on a different amendment? Well, you asked me to change the subject, so that's why I abide it. I'm discussing the Secretary for Justice, the SB, and the police. They are the three big enforcement bodies in Hong Kong. State differs from state machinery. State refers to the fact that people in the state said that they will serve all people of that state.
So if you beat me up or I beat you up, then the state will stop me or you. But then the state machinery serves the state, and their objectives run contrary to the objectives of the state. Examples are the prisons, the police, and we do not want to see state machinery expanding because state machinery is intended to exercise control. What we can see is that the Communist Party saw the umbrella movement, and so the Communist Party had to make use of state machinery to suppress people that it wanted to suppress. In 1967, the British Hong Kong government relied on the police to suppress dissidents, and then the police corruption became rampant, and as a result, we needed the ICAC. And so if the state machinery is being abused, everybody will suffer. Mr. Leung, when you speak, please do not keep pointing the finger in my direction because I feel very disturbed. All right, then I will point the finger in the other direction. In 1965, there was the riot relating to Star Ferry. 1967, there was the anti-British riot, and the government relied on the police. The police became more powerful. There was rampant corruption within the police force. And then in the Cultural Revolution, there were military representatives. Lin Biao wanted to take over the power. Mr. Leung Kwok-hung, I think you have digressed. No, I haven't. I'm talking about the state machinery. The three departments. Government is relying on them to deal with the consequences arising out of the umbrella movement. Please come back to the Hong Kong SAR government. I want to say that we saw another example, or one example, in 1967. Yes, you see that the state machinery is expanding. It is expanding. In the future, the same things will happen. This is because the government has to make use of the state machinery to deal with the opponents, and the state machinery will expand, and there will be a lot of corruption. Do you know that collusion and corruption arise because of excessive powers? And I think this is the source of corruption. This is simple. If Andy Zhang and Rimsky-Yun, the Secretary for Justice, if they collude and act in this manner, then in the future, those who are their friends will be released. Those who are their enemies will be arrested. In fact, I have asked over 200 times why the seven police officers have not been dealt with and have not been prosecuted. If seven LegCo members besiege you, Chairman, and kick you outside this building, will we not be prosecuted? Will people say that they can't see what is happening? Now, Chairman, I want to say that I am attacking this state machinery. Of course, I dislike its nature, but if a ruling regime relies on secret agents and the state machinery to rule the people, then this ruling regime will collapse. It will definitely collapse. This is because the state machinery will make use of its special powers and privileges to bully people, and they will become corrupt. I want to say that if 100 girls walk on the street in the nighttime, that would be very scary indeed. And such scary things are caused by the ruling regime relying on the state machinery to suppress dissidents. I now adjourn the council till next Wednesday, 11 a.m.